guys, welcome back to my channel. I'm going to be showing you today how I painted a dragonfly in a bokeh background. I'm going to go ahead and list the colors that I used. You don't have to use the exact same colors if you have a basic yellow, blue, red, and if you want to use a green, you can do that too. I do use a transparent mixing white as well as a regular titanium white. The transparent mixing white is really nice because it's got a translucent gloss to it, so it's really nice for the bokeh background that we're going to be doing. Right now I'm going to go ahead and pick up some white, some olive green, and a little bit of that phthalo green. And I've got a 3-inch flat brush, which is really good for what we're going to be doing. It's really good to just get that paint on there. I always use it for my backgrounds when I'm doing a sky or whatever I'm doing, just to block in that color. It's really, really nice for blending, and you want a large brush when you're covering a canvas so you can blend quickly when working with acrylic. I'm just doing all sorts of variations of greens, so the only main thing that you really have to make sure is wherever your light source is going, make sure obviously that that back part is going to be the brightest. In this case, my light source is going to be coming from the left side, so I'm going to have the left side of the canvas be a lot lighter and the right side a lot darker. So I just went ahead and put a little bit, I'm grabbing more and more of that olive green just to darken that right side up. I chose today to do a dragonfly because I love how their body looks iridescent, and I really wanted to capture that in a painting, and I also wanted to go ahead and do a bokeh background, so I'm pretty excited about it. Now, I'm not doing anything in particular other than just trying to achieve a nice blurred background. And so I'm doing some circular motions, but it really doesn't matter at this point. You can just put on the paint as you please, because we are going to cover these in the bokeh dots. So don't get hung up on trying to perfect this step and trying to blur it out completely. I'm just kind of going with what I feel like. So now that I've got the canvas completely covered, I'm gonna start on my bokeh dots. This is kind of the fun part. We're gonna actually be doing a little bit of finger painting, which is what I like to do in a lot of my paintings. That's the best way for me sometimes to blend things out. I'm always touching the canvas with my fingers, and I've just found that sometimes it's the best tool to be able to use. So I encourage you to try it. I'm gonna apply the color with a paintbrush, and then you will see me go back through and start blending those out with my finger. And eventually I will just be using my finger to do the bokeh dots. I'm doing just a yellow color with a tint of that green left over, and I'm using a filbert brush to apply that. Now, when you're doing your bokeh background, you really want to focus on trying to do different size circles, and you want to have them overlapping each other. And that's why I like to use the translucent white when I mix my colors. And eventually, once this layer dries, because I am working this completely into it's wet on wet basically. The paint underneath is not completely dry, and it does help because you can achieve some really cool effects when you are putting your dots on. Now, at the end, when I've completed the dragonfly, I am gonna go back through with just plain translucent white straight from the tube. It's gonna be really sheer looking, and I'm gonna apply that over some of these spots once this part is completed. So it's that translucent mixing white is really awesome for trying to get just a really sheer, beautiful coverage that pretty much you can almost see the layers underneath coming through. And so things like the bokeh background, and let's say even if you're doing sun rays, I use my translucent mixing white for a lot of sun ray effects too. So it's really nice to have on hand, and I get mine, it's just the basics Liquitex brand, and I think pretty much every brand has a mixing white, translucent mixing white. But I just use the one from Liquitex Basics, and I really like it. So when you're applying your bokeh dots, like I was saying, just make sure you're doing different sizes, all different sizes, and overlapping each one. And when you're using that translucent mixing white, you're gonna see how they overlap, but you can see the ones underneath come through. It's just a really awesome effect, and it's perfect for what we're doing today. Now, if you don't have any of that translucent mixing white on hand, you don't have to use that. You can use your titanium white and you can thin it down and almost make a glaze out of it with just using a little bit more water, so it will be almost translucent. It's just probably gonna be a little runnier, so it might not work as well as the translucent mixing white, but you can still use that. So now I'm just taking dots of the translucent white straight from the tube and just blotting it on. And you know, just rubbing my finger in there, trying to brighten up some certain spots that I want to brighten up.
Thank you.
So as I said before, I'm trying to focus on the left side of the canvas. That's where my light source is gonna be. So I'm putting in a little bit more yellow in that area just to have some little bright spots here and there. Just straight yellow from the tube. Like I said, you can do your dots however you want to. You can make them whatever colors you want. I'm just kind of doing whatever I feel like doing, you know, and just have fun with it. It doesn't have to be perfect. That's what's fun about this technique, because, you know, they're all different. And if you look up pictures of bokeh backgrounds, you'll see that, you know, they're just all random. And as long as you're focusing on where your light source is, having those bright dots come out, and then the darker areas, having the dark spots, you'll be fine. You'll be good to go. I think that you'll really like doing this. And then once you put your main focus on, once we put our dragonfly on, or if you want to, you know, if we were doing a bird, let's say, or whatever, it's really gonna pop out, and it's gonna blur that background. So I think you'll like the results you get when you do this. So now I'm taking a little bit of the phthalo green and cadmium yellow and titanium white, and I'm putting in just a flower stem and some leaves. And I want the sun to be kind of illuminating through the dragonfly and the plant that we're gonna put in. So I wanted it to be really bright around the edges of everything. So when you look at a plant up close, some of them, they're almost like furry looking in the light, like if it's a really bright day out. And that's what I wanted to capture in this painting also. I just wanted everything to be illuminated. And even the dragonfly that we put in is gonna have like some hair on it, and you're gonna be able to see, we're gonna put in little wisps of his hair. So I wanted to capture those little details, because I just wanted, that's what makes the painting you know, pop. That's what really, you know, makes it come to life, those little details. And I just, those are the, you know, effects that I wanted to capture today. So I'm brightening up my green and yellow mixture even more, and I'm coming down with my flat brush. This is a 1-inch flat brush. I'm coming down the sides, and I'm gonna go around all the edges of the flower stem with this. And I'm gonna keep going back and forth, brightening up, darkening up, everything on here to make it stand out and add detail. This brush came in a set of, basically there was flat brushes, filbert brushes, and then some round brushes. And it also came with an angled brush, which I love. I'm not using it in this painting, but I use it almost in all my paintings. I love a good angled brush. They're not expensive at all. I got them from Hobby Lobby, and I really like the length of the brushes that I have. They're, I believe they're Master's Touch brand, like in the complete pack, value pack. I don't spend a lot on my brushes. There's one brush in particular that I'm going to link below that we will be using here in a little bit. And it is so awesome. It's the only brush that I will order. I can't find it anywhere else, like in any of the craft stores that we have around here, but it's perfect for little tiny hairs and grass, for just anything, really. I mean, it's perfect for just a bunch of different effects. So I'm gonna go ahead and show you that one in just a little bit when we start adding the little furry details on stuff. So I'm switching to my round brush, and I'm putting together a light mixture of yellow and white, a little tiny bit of that green I'm dragging in there, but mostly it's gonna be yellow and white. I'm just, like I said, building up that detail from darkest to lightest. And getting around those edges. So yeah, the length of these brushes are great. I really love the long handle on them. They just work nicely. They're not expensive. And I just really like that. I love that set that I got. I can't remember how much I paid for, maybe like $11.99 or something like that, or somewhere around there. I can't remember exactly, but just dragging up the edges of this plant, trying to illuminate it. So I grabbed even a little bit more white. Again, I'm using my finger to blend things out. And I'm always dipping my brush in a little bit of water and then I wipe it off so it's not dripping wet. But I almost always work with a somewhat wet brush. It just helps everything move along nicely. Now this brush is the one I was talking about. This is the one I ordered from Amazon. You can see those tiny little bristles. It's called a feathered rake brush. And this thing is so perfect for little details. And just adding, you know, a bunch of little grassy details. I use it for dotting things. If I'm doing like a pretty sunset, you know, and I want some of that shimmer on the, you know, waves, I just dot that on with this. It's perfect for stuff like that. Fur on animals. I mean, this thing is really, really awesome. I love it so much. So I'm taking white, and you don't want to glob it on your brush. You want to get it on just enough where the bristles are covered in the paint, not completely all smooshed in there, and you don't want it like dripping off, because you want to keep those bristles separated. So you don't want a bunch of paint weighing it down. So just really gently just grab your white, kind of brush it off a little bit, so that way you've got that paint just right on the edges of those bristles, and start painting. I'm pushing in and pulling out, like swiping out on the canvas. And at, you know, certain spots I will blot it on and dot it on when I use my bright white. Now I'm picking up more of that phthalo green, and I'm trying to incorporate some of the shadows. So I'm just putting that on right now. It's really just a back and forth process. Lots of layers of highlights and shadows back and forth. So now I'm dipping into the pure titanium white. I want a very opaque white at this point, and see how I just showed you how you need to have that on your brush, just blotting it on almost on your palette, and getting the paint on just enough where each bristle is still separated. So I'm blotting on my brightest white right now to really make this glow and the highlights shine. And when I'm dotting it on, I'm not gonna just drag white all around this thing. It's kind of like a less is more type thing. You know, if you have all white covered around this and there's no other colors in there, then it's not going to stand out. So, you know, in order for your brightest whites to stand out, it needs to be, you still need to have some of that depth in there. So, you know, just kind of blotting this on in certain areas, like the brightest white straight from the tube is perfect. I mean, you don't need the entire thing, you know, illuminated. Just here and there, because that's what's going to make it stand out, having that depth against it. Thank you. Now I've switched back to my round brush with some of my white, and I'm trying to put some of those highlights on the leaves, trying to bring that out just a little more. Right on the ends, you just want them, you just want to make that stand out right on the tips of those leaves where the sun will be hitting it. I'm just using pure white, and like I said before, I'm working mostly wet into wet right now. The layers beneath this, you know, the what I'm applying now, it's not completely dry. So even though we're adding pure white, it's still mixing in a little bit when I'm blending it with my finger. So it just looks, it's kind of like gives it a glowing effect. Dipping into yellow just a little bit to brighten up some things. And you don't have to go as detailed. Yeah, I mean, you don't have to keep going back and forth. It might seem kind of counterproductive to some people, but I just feel like when I do this, I'm building up the layers. And although it may seem like I'm covering up what I just did, I'm blending things out, and I'm using a lot of glazing when I'm mixing these colors. I'm using some of that translucent mixing white, so they're not all opaque colors. So you're gonna get a lot of, a lot of those pretty layers coming through, and I just feel like it just works for me. So I mean, you can do it however way you want to. I picked up some more of the phthalo blue. Phthalo green, and incorporating those shadows again. Like I said, I can't stress to you enough, the back and forth process of what I mean by going from light to dark, but I just feel like it really gives it something more, so. So now I'm going to be sketching in the dragonfly. I switched to a small round brush. And I'm just going to go ahead and grab some phthalo blue and some white. Just pure titanium white is fine. So I'm going to go ahead and block it in with I'm leaning more towards darker blue because I'm going to be building up my highlights. So starting off with just a pretty blue color. I'm just kind of sketching them in. I didn't really realize that I made my dragonfly a little bit on the hefty side. You don't have to make yours quite as hefty looking, but that's okay. He's pleasantly plump, so you just do yours however you want to. I'm going to be adding some wings to kind of cover him up a little bit anyway. Thank you. So I'm just going through and taking my black, putting it in where he's gonna have some shadows, like the divots in between where his eye meets his face, and coming down, just to have a starting point as to where my shadows are gonna be going. And then, of course, you know, they have a really pretty design on them, so I'll be blocking that in with the black as well. And I'm just taking his little legs out. Working with a wet brush and swirling it on my palette as I'm picking up this black, because I want it to have a nice pointed edge. Don't get too hung up on the details. All we're doing is just blocking the color in so we have a starting point. I am kind of just putting in some lighter blues, marbling it on. Sometimes I get ahead of myself and I'm just so eager to do those details. But, you know, if you just put on your layer of dark blue just to give yourself a starting point, that's good. Just to get somewhere, you know, and I always find it easier for me, and not everybody is the same way, but I always find it easier to start off on my darker side, darker than what I intend. I don't know why, I just feel like it turns out better rather than having lighter colors and working from light to dark. So I just feel like that's the easiest for me. And we are going to be finger painting again. I am going to be applying little, you know, drops of paint here and there and kind of marbling it out with my finger in a little bit once we start putting on the details. It's, you know, each little portion of the dragonfly, like I said before, they're almost iridescent looking, and like the transition from all of their colors on their body, it's really nicely blended. So for me, like working wet on wet is a big thing for me. It makes it easier, and then I can just take my finger and blend it on through, and it just really works well, much better than if I was to try to do it with a brush. We'll be right back. also taking that same brush after I've cleaned it off really well. I'm trying to illuminate his legs with that white, just white from the tube, straight pure titanium white. Just very, very softly. Doesn't have to be perfect. I am going to go back through with that little rake brush and we're going to add some little furry details to his legs even. So I'm switching back to the rake brush. I've got a little bit of that white and I'm not even really doing anything except dabbing it on. I'm not really moving my brush too much. I'm pulling out a little bit, but honestly, just dabbing it on is perfectly fine because these are such fine little hairs. So just little dots along the edges of his legs. So switching back to the small round brush, I've got black on the very tip of my brush and I'm kind of outlining some little random shapes. This is just the design of the dragonfly, and every single dragonfly that I've seen is different, and so there's no rhyme or reason to this, just, you know, little designs is fine. They have sort of, you know, like on his tail, it's gonna kind of go up and around like I'm doing now. It doesn't have to be perfect, like I said. We're gonna be adding more to this just as just a little basic guide. That's all I'm doing right now, just a guide. I mean, right now it definitely looks like a kindergartner's art project, I'm sure, but, you know, this is just a starting point. Paintings always go through a really ugly stage, and you just have to stick with it because you know, it will become something beautiful. Just keep adding those layers of detail, and you know, it's so easy to change because acrylic dries so fast that it's forgiving. And you know, you don't give up on a painting just because you think it's ugly, because seriously, every single one of my paintings that I've done always goes through an ugly stage, and you just have to ignore it. So right around the edges of where I applied the black, I'm going to start applying my lighter color. It's just a mixture of that blue and white. And I'm just blending it out with my finger. grab some of that red and phthalo blue and white. Now I'm going to be adding it to the tops of his eyes. Making sure that you're not covering up the entire eye, blending it out with your finger. It's going to give such a nice effect and some depth to it. It'll really start to take form when you start doing this. And now I'm incorporating the dark. So going back through and putting a little more shadows on the sky with just the red and blue, less titanium white, just a darker purple. Now I've got the rake brush, and I'm starting to apply the fuzzy details around him, blotting it on, really, really soft, just ever so softly. Going along the back edge of him. I have a really bad habit of wiping paint on everything around me to clean my brush off. It's really bad. So yeah, I definitely just used my easel as a rag basically for my brush. And most of the time I use my pants. I don't even think I have anything left that doesn't have paint on it. So you're just lightly dragging up, blotting and dragging. This part of the dragonfly is pretty much like everything that I'm doing going over is dry. And you want it to be dry when you're putting on these fine details. You don't want to do this when it's still wet. Like there was a wet part right there and it just dragged out and it was gray. So yeah, you just want to make sure that what you're going over is pretty dry. Now comes the fun part, which is making his wings. And I'm using translucent paint. You really, really want to try to, at least if you don't have translucent mixing white, try to really thin your white down, because you want just a very translucent paint. And I'm just literally blending it all out with my finger. I want it to just barely be there. I mean, you want little, we will be adding a lot of highlights to his wings, but you don't want to outline it completely in white. It'll look kind of cartoonish if you do that. So if you're going for a more realistic look, then try to just, you know, just blend it out very, very soft, very translucent. I'm adding little bits of color throughout it, like peaches and, you know, like a pink color. Not a lot of color, just a little bit. And I'm gonna go back through and cover, you know, go over it with just a little, like little specks of highlights. Now I've got a rigger brush from Princeton. I like this brush a lot. And I've wet it and blotted it off and swirled it, just the end, just swirled it in the white, titanium white. I'm adding the details of the wings. And I'm just gonna basically be following I'm doing squiggly lines across and then squiggly lines down, not straight lines. I mean, some of them can be straighter than others, but just random little shapes, because if you look at their wings, there's a pattern, but not every little detail of their wing is like the other. So just random little spots. And I'm not doing a pattern throughout the entire wing, only in certain areas, because I want it to give the illusion that the sun is hitting it only in certain spots. I don't want it to be throughout all of the wings, everywhere. Just little bits here and there.
Hey, Olivia? Olivia?
Now I'm going through with a palette knife. I don't know if most of you have used one or if you prefer it or not. I love using a palette knife for so many different things. When you look at their wings in the sunlight, they have like a diamond crystal looking effect on their wings, and it just shimmers so pretty. And I've found that to get that effect on a lot of things, like his wings, is with the palette knife. I mean, and it's so simple. You want it dry paint, obviously it's going to be a dry palette knife. You don't want any water. You want it to be stiffer paint. And you want just a little bit on your brush, not a ton, because you want it to hit certain areas and almost you want it to look marbled. It's just going to be really pretty. I use the palette knife for a lot of highlighted effects, like, you know, on my water. I put it flat, like the flat side down, and I don't have like a ton of paint piled up on it, just enough to cover a little, you know, just a little layer of it is all you need. And you just almost just kind of in a circular motion, kind of lightly push it across. That's why you don't want a lot. You just want it to hit certain spots. So I picked up a little bit of yellow on my brush and went over some of those white spots just to give it some more color in those areas. So now I'm taking titanium white straight from the tube. Again, everything's pretty well dry in this area right now, so I'm going back through with another layer to do his fur. And I'm really piling on that white on the tips of those bristles so they really pop out and stand out, and I can really get this little guy glowing. Now I'm gonna go ahead and start putting on some details on his body, mixing some of that red and blue and white for that almost a mauve color. And I'm just going through random spots, just trying to build up a little bit of that color on him. Blending it out with my finger. You can do any colors that you want. So now that I've got a complete dry background, I'm taking the translucent white straight from the tube, and I am just making little circles around the edges. And see how when you're adding these circles with that translucent mixing white, you can see the layers below it or underneath it come through. This is such a pretty effect. I love how it just shows all these different variations of color through the paint, and it gives it a really pretty look to it. And I definitely picked up some blue. I don't know how that happened. I think I had some on my paint bottle, but I just went with it. So I actually liked the blue in there. And like I said, I don't think I could do this as well if I did it with a paintbrush. I really like to just use my finger. I mean, it works the best for me, and I get a perfect little circle with it. And it's quicker. So just randomly in different spots, this is gonna help pull it all together. Putting some on the other side too. So I decided to brighten up his wings a little bit more. So I got my palette knife out, got a little bit of that paint on there, just softly gliding it along. I just want his wings to sparkle. That's kind of see how I'm just rubbing it on in circular motions? It's gonna give it that really pretty highlighted look. And now I'm going through and just trying to achieve a little glow around his body, the tail, just using white, the translucent mixing white. That's all I'm doing. So I'm just going through and finalizing all of the brightest highlights, making sure everything just glows beautifully. And I hope that you guys really enjoyed this video. So if you have any comments or suggestions, feel free to leave them below, and I will see you all next time. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you.